You are love,
us recite together this prayer, the deepest truth. We believe in God, maker of all things, provider of all things, who loves all people. We follow Jesus, in whom salvation has come to us. He sees us for who we are, heals the wounds of our hearts, and makes us new. In his death and resurrection, we see the deepest truth of life. We live by the power of the Holy Spirit, which empowers us for self-giving love. We give thanks for the church, the body of Christ, and for the gift of forgiveness, the power of resurrection, and the mystery of eternal life. Amen. During this song, we're going to present our tithes and offerings to God, and if you're at home, you can lift up your offering as well. Together, prayer, dedication. Lord God, giver of every good and perfect gift, we thank you for your faithful provision for our lives. Please accept these, our tithes and offerings, as a token of our humble gratitude and eternal love. May your will always be done here on earth, just as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us enter together into a time of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you that you have gifted us this church, that we could come here, whether in person or online, and see our friends, brothers and sisters in Christ. And we pray for those friends, Lord. We know that each one of us comes broken and bruised. Only in you are we made whole. We pray for a few of our friends in particular. We pray for Catherine Hoffman and Bill Masterson. Together this time in Lee Senior Living Center, and we pray that you are healing both of them, not just in body, but also in spirits. We also pray for Kathy Plymeyer as she continues to get over her hip replacement. We're thankful that the healing has been so quick. Just pray that you can sustain it for her. We also pray for all those in our congregation who are suffering with cancer or dealing with serious health issues, Lord. Each of us comes with so many people that we know in that condition, in that place. Lord, we pray that you can be with every soul, that you can heal not only their body, but also help their heart to be reassured that you are there. Lord, we're grateful to our church staff. We're grateful to our pastor as well. We pray for Pastor Jim and his wife Donna as they are on vacation this week. We pray that this time is a wonderful time for them and their family, that they're surrounded by all of their children, and that the love and peace that they have in that family will just saturate them in this good time. We pray for his safe return, and we also pray for everybody who has helped this church, laity and staff. We are so blessed. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've given us. We also pray for the city in which we reside. We pray for our leaders, in particular the youth. We pray that you would be with them and that somehow you would help our ministries to touch each and every one of them. We pray, Lord, that not only can you be with this church, but the entire church, all of Christendom. We pray that you can bless what we do, that it may glorify you, that we can focus on you and you alone. We pray this, as well as the many prayers that are on each and every heart of those with us this morning. We pray this in the blessed name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hello, everyone. We have some announcements this morning, as you heard in the prayer. Obviously, I am not Pastor Jim, but we will try and fill in as best we can. If you are watching online, please register with us. Please let us know that you're worshiping with us. It's nice for us to see, as well as everybody who's worshiping alongside you. It's about the best that most of us can do during this time where we're all separated, so it's just, I know it means a lot to see those familiar names for everyone. And as I mentioned earlier, we have quite a few prayer warriors in this congregation, so no prayer will go left unprayed for. As far as logistics of getting back to church, next week will be our first week back. And if you are in need of a face mask, there have been a lot of folks diligently working to make them, as you can see in this picture here. There are quite a few available. If you need one, please let somebody know. We'll be glad to help. So, as I mentioned, next Sunday will be the wonderful return of in-person worship at both of our worship services. So, the 9 o'clock service will go on as it has for many weeks. Yes, I see somebody clapping. That is a blessing that we're back. And at 10:30, we're going to try it out. And you know what? We're going to worship God one way or another. So it's going to be a good thing. There are going to be some rules and things that Pastor Jim he's done such a wonderful job of trying to get ahead of. And here they are. So we're going to remind everyone, if you don't feel comfortable, just don't come. It's okay. We will still have the online worship, obviously. you know, mask wearing will be recommended, as all the health guides, and there will be a lot of other things. So there's seating arrangements that have been made. There are places for there to wash your hands, hand sanitize your hands, and we want to remind everybody that we're trying to not touch things. So we'll try and avoid handshakes and hugs for the most part, right? The other thing is, depending on how many people we get, we're going to try to attend only one service. So it's just the idea being that if we do have too many people coming, we don't want somebody to not worship at all. So that's a guideline that we're going to try for a little bit. We'll see how things go, of course. The healthy community walk that is going to benefit the Erie United Methodist Alliance is coming upon us. It's not this coming Tuesday, but the one after that. So a group of us are going to be walking. We're going to get together at the first parking lot on Presque Isle on June 23rd at 10 o'clock a.m. And again, thank you to Susan and Pastor Adonna for coordinating that. It's a wonderful place for our mission money to go. Rise Against Hunger, Pastor Jim's been talking about this. We're still looking to raise some money, so be mindful of that when you are looking at making offerings to church. The logistics of how this is going to happen will definitely be evolving between now and Saturday, October 3rd. But please mark your calendars, and we're going to figure out how we're going to do that. I believe that is the last announcement slide. So let's do the children's message. So I have a question. Hi, Valerie. This goes for everybody here. Have you ever been lied to? Oh yeah, I see some lying. Anybody not been lied to? Maybe that's a better way to put it. Recently. It's tough. There's a lot of times people will accidentally lie. And I say, I'll be there by 4:30, and then they're not there by 4:30, right? Are we ever late?
Yeah.
He's honest. He's honest. We're late more than I would like, that's for sure. But that's part of life. Sometimes there are lies that aren't so honest, and that's really sad too. But I have a question. Can you think of somebody who tells the truth? Valerie, who tells the truth?
God.
Thank you, Claire. God, yes, God tells the truth. Who else tells the truth?
Moses.
Yeah, Moses told the truth. Not all the time. I think he messed up once or twice.
Can you think of anyone who matters?
All right. Well, we had some good answers. God definitely tells the truth. And Moses probably wasn't too bad either. He got one of those commandments about not bearing false witness. Well, God tells the truth all the time. He's the only one that tells the truth all the time. Even Peter, when he told the truth and said that God is Lord and that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, wasn't but a day later, or a few days later, that he denied knowing Christ, and he lied about that. So nobody's perfect, not even Peter. Let's all say a prayer together. Lord God, we pray that you can help us to be truth bearers, that we will not stumble into lies, and also, Lord, that we can rely on your truth and look to you alone, and to not be fooled by any of the deceptions that come into our lives. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
All right. Well, our Bible lesson this morning is from Matthew chapter 16. I'm going to kind of bury it in the middle of the sermon, so let's have a moment of prayer before we reflect upon God's holy word. Lord God, we pray that your spirit can enter this room, that it can enter all of the rooms the people worshiping with us on their computer or their phone. We pray that you can be with every Christian now, this morning and at every moment. You can make us whole as only you can do. And we pray, Lord, that you could somehow transform the words that come out of my mouth into something that will glorify you. We pray this all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. So, as I was talking with the children, you know, have you ever had somebody play a trick on you? A real good practical joke. You know, it's funny sometimes when we get fooled. It's just a good joke. It's a laugh for everybody. And other times, not so much. It's not funny when it costs you something, whether it's your pride or maybe it costs some real money. And then there are things in life that are outright deceptions. How about a time where you bought something and you went to the store and you were told it's something that's high quality, you're going to buy something, it's good. Then you find out it's cheap, it was made in China. It's just destined for the landfill, it breaks within a day of getting it home. I don't like being fooled that way, I don't know about you. Or when you're sold on a great job opportunity, this may have happened once or twice in your life, you think it's something you can do, make a real difference, change things. Spend your hours working for something that matters, but after a few days or months or years, you find out it was just another job, another dollar, another day. Or worse still, you ask someone for help, perhaps a close friend, and you relied on them, and they betrayed your trust. That's certainly not good. What if you trusted someone to tell the truth when you needed them most, and later found out it just wasn't so? We live in a world where truth seems to be becoming more and more elusive. It's hard to find truth, isn't it? Take, for instance, this coronavirus. At first, it seemed everybody, overreacted. And then there was a lot of finger pointing for being unprepared. And the guidance we get even now, it doesn't often add up, at least to me. Stay home, but you can leave home if you need to get essential things. But you're not essential. Well, everybody's essential. Remember reading a while back that we shouldn't buy masks because they weren't necessary, and then suddenly we had to because they were mandatory. And then we read that we'll only be safe if there's a vaccine. You can find as many articles about how there won't ever be a vaccine. It's getting worse. It's almost over. It lives on surfaces. It's in the air. It's not on surfaces. It's heavier than the air, so don't worry about it. There's a second wave coming. There won't be a second wave. It's mutating. Don't see people. Well, you can see people, but only if you're 10 feet away. No, 6 feet away. Only if you wear a mask. It's nuts, right? But Pastor Jim, he's done a wonderful job. I really, really admire the guy. Has he tried to keep up with all of this insanity. He's been calm and helpful throughout all of it, very objective. It's a wonder he hasn't gone insane. But more recently now, we have news about these protests. It's sad, really. There's buildings burning on television, and yet there's newscasters standing in front of them saying that we're seeing peaceful protests. In early May, said in early May, protesters were villains, risking a second wave of the coronavirus, and in June, they're heroes. Then we hear that some violence is okay, and it's justified because of other violence in the past. A prominent leader within our own United Methodist denomination recently stated that some violence is acceptable because it is concomitant with 400 years of systematic violence. When did one wrong start correcting another wrong? Unfortunately, we're confronted with a lot of conflicting information, conflicting perspectives, and maybe just some bad logic. Confusion is understandable. It's part of life. Disagreement is to be expected. Much of this confusion, it probably doesn't have malicious intent. Maybe even all of it is innocent. But as Christians, we need to be aware that deceit is one of the primary tools of a character in the Bible we too often forget. It can be difficult to remember that as Christians, we are called not to be of the world, but only to pass through it. We need to remember that there's actually a cosmic battle raging, a battle of souls being saved, and unfortunately some being lost. A battle of angels and demons. There are hints of this in Scripture. If you think of Daniel chapter 10, an amazing chapter in the Bible, the angel Michael fights for 21 days, as it turns out, so that Daniel can get a message about a dream and a vision he has had. We know from Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers of darkness, and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Think about that for a moment. We get so absorbed in the lives and the world that we see. A fun quote is, "The greatest trick of the devil is convincing people he doesn't exist." I did a little research, and at least the internet told me that this quote originated with Frenchman Charles Baudelaire. Now, there may be some schools of thought within Christianity that actually believe that Lucifer was never an angel figure, never an actual person, so to speak, but just a symbolic force. That may be the case for some. I think it's probably more likely for most of us that we simply fall victim to our five senses, and particularly that we pay attention to what we see around us, and we might just forget about Satan. Charles Baudelaire's full quote was a little more wordy. "One of the artifices of Satan is to induce men to believe that he does not exist. Another, perhaps equally fatal, is to make them fancy that he is obliged to stand by quietly and not to meddle with them if they get into true silence." That's a little bit deeper. The second part of that is that Satan is just standing quietly by and not actually interfering with our lives or the world at large. A few years later, a pastor named William Ramsey echoed that sentiment in 1856 in a book that he wrote, Spiritualism, a Satanic Delusion, and a Sign of the Times. His full quote, and if you care to read it, it's on the screen as well, but "one of the most striking proofs of the personal existence of Satan, which our times afford us," so that you can see back then, even as now, they thought that they were living in critical times, "is found in the fact that he has influenced the minds of multitudes in reference to his existence and doings, as to make them believe that he does not exist, and that the hosts of demons or evil spirits over whom he presides as prince are only fantasies of the brain or a hallucination of the mind. But could we have stronger proof of the existence of a mind so mighty as to produce those results?" Is the church aware that we too can be deceived? Can a congregation, a denomination, or perhaps even all of us be deceived? Unfortunately, the answer is yes. If we look in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting in verse 8, we can read, "Then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord shall slay with the breath of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is after the working of Satan, with all the power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they refuse to love the truth, so they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them a strong delusion, that they should believe a lie." Now hold on here, you might be thinking. That's about the end times. That's a special case. Well, yes, it is the end. Maybe not today, but that is definitely referring to the end times of the Bible. But perhaps there's another way to look at this. Maybe some of you are feeling as if 2020 has done a fairly decent job so far of qualifying as the end of the world. But even if it's not, we've got to remember that God operates outside of time. He's not like us who can only see the moment that's right before us. His perspective is a little bit more as if he was looking at a parade from the top of a very tall building. When he looks down, he can see the beginning of that parade, the middle, and the end, all at the same time. But we're caught up in the middle of that parade, and we can only see just about right in front of us. It'd be pretty handy to rely on that vantage point of God, wouldn't it? God is that for us. His truth is like a lighthouse high upon a rock. His truth is unwavering. He is solid. He is a beacon. And he is true. In the last few months, there's been a lot of bad news, some of it wrong, probably even some of it fake. You've probably heard this before, that a lie will go around the world while the truth is still putting its boots on. I really like that one. Much of the misinformation, it may be unintentional, but I think we would be wise to remember that the father of lies is still at work. And it seems he is even able to take an innocent mistake and craft it into a magnificent deception. A verse that echoes in my mind a haunting question is surprisingly not one asked by Jesus or written by Paul or uttered by a prophet. Rather, it came from a pagan Roman, probably a very cruel person. In John chapter 18, verse 38, Pontius Pilate asked Christ such a short question, and yet perhaps one of the most potent philosophical inquiries that was ever made. He asked, "What is truth?" Christ did not respond, which might kill you for a minute. You think we could have heard the answer to that question. But I think he didn't respond because he didn't have to. If we look at John chapter 14, verse 6, I think that may hold the answer. It's one of the seven I am statements of Christ, where he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." God is truth, Christ, and Christ alone. He didn't have to answer because he was the answer. We must anchor ourselves in God's truth, especially when a storm rages around us. In a time such as this, when everything in the world seems upside down, when so little seems good and trustworthy, and when even that seems to be under attack, we have to embrace God's Holy Spirit, dwell in his truth. And in a way, we can step out of the division, the confusion, the deceit, and the doubt. What a diversion we have in front of us. What a distraction we have from the truth. I think Peter saw the truth. In our gospel scripture for today, Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 20, I'd like you to just close your eyes as I read through this and imagine that you are perhaps one of those disciples sitting there listening to Jesus and this conversation that ensues. I'll begin verse 13. When Jesus came to the coasts of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Whom do men say that I am, the Son of Man?" And they said, "Well, some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And Jesus said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed it to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I say also to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he charged the disciples that no one should tell that he was Jesus the Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So did anybody catch that? What was the truth there? Who had that truth? Peter. The truth that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Christianity has been consistently persecuted throughout history. It wasn't too long after Peter made that profound statement that he was being persecuted and he folded under pressure. It still is being persecuted in many countries, and Sadly, based on the news lately, the era of Christianity being a dominant or even an accepted part of Western culture may be drawing to a close. Pastor Jerry Waldrop, Mississippi, this is a rather sad picture of him, but this was taken the day that he was president of his church for a very sad time. He said, "I never thought that in America I'd experience what it was like for armed policemen to hand me an official government document ordering our community of faithful to cease and desist worshiping on Easter Sunday and to depart the house of God." And then, on May 21st, his church in Mississippi was destroyed by a suspected arsonist fire about a month after he had filed a lawsuit in response to that closure. This church, which had proceeded to challenge that order, was ultimately burned down. And the graffiti that you can see in the lower portion of that picture that was found at the scene said, "Bet you stay home now, you hypocrites." News like this can be sad, it can be discouraging. Not being able to worship together is tough on all of us. It's something that's fundamental to being Christian. And then to sit at home alone and watch society crumble around us with good people being attacked, that's just downright heartbreaking. It has been said that persecution has caused the church to thrive throughout history. This was certainly true during the Reformation or the purges that came before it and during it, or the Inquisitions, or even during that Roman period of martyrdom where thousands of early Christians were brutally murdered. However, when you're in the thick of it, it does look bleak. Which is why, as Christians, as individuals, as congregations, and as a whole, we can't find ourselves participating in that fighting or despair. We need to focus on our real fight, a fight with the real enemy of God's plan. The only real enemy that we face is the father of lies. We don't often acknowledge that the angel Lucifer is a real character, not only in Scripture, but he's still at work. He's the accuser, the prince of this world. Those are but a few of dozens of titles. 37 seems to be the count that most people agree upon that he has. At any rate, whatever you call him, he's real and he is busy. Now, is he going to defeat God or foil God's plan? Certainly not. Is he God's equal? No way. But is he stirring up a whole lot of trouble? You betcha. Recall Jesus said to the Pharisees in an angry moment, he said, "You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies." His plan has ever been to foil God's plan. If you look at the Bible, it's really a narrative of how this figure has tried to thwart God's intention. Everything from the apple in the garden, to the Tower of Babel, to Joseph's brothers selling him into slavery, the temptation of David through Bathsheba, the killing of the prophets, the nearly successful attempts to end the royal line of David and thus prevent Christ being born. And we can't forget the slaughter of all of those young babes in Bethlehem, or even the crucifixion of Christ, or the slaughter of the early Christians. And that's just probably naming a few. And in the future, there's a time that has yet to come, the time of Jacob's trouble, which will be the final chapter of Israel's persecution, and perhaps the final time where Satan tries to thwart God's plan. His character is real. He has never been idle, and he is certainly not idle now. Yet thankfully, we do have this amazing shield. We don't have to fight him. We have the Holy Spirit. Amen. I know a few Christians whose favorite chapter in the Bible seems to be Ephesians chapter 6. Listen to these words. "Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can make your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this world's darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil and heavenly realms. Therefore, take up the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you will be able to stand your ground. And having done everything to stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled about your waist, the breastplate of righteousness arrayed, and your feet fitted with the readiness of the gospel of peace. In addition to this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is in the Word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times with every kind of prayer and petition. To this end, stay alert with perseverance in your prayers for all the saints. Pray for me also, that whenever I open my mouth, words may be given to you, so that I will boldly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Now, there are six by many people's counts. I try to include prayer as the seventh. I think it's the heavy artillery, so to speak. When what you adorn for battle isn't enough, you can always call in for backup, and it's the best backup ever. When you can't duke it out on your own, you can call in for the heavy firepower. Now, if we think back to Daniel, who was praying and had angels fighting over whether or not he would receive an answer, perhaps the next time you're praying for someone or yourself, perhaps you might imagine that there could be an angel of evil and an angel of good standing about you, clashing, or that you could be somehow working this magical, mysterious Holy Spirit, which seems to work in tandem with prayer throughout all of Scripture. Let's look back on verse 14, the belt of truth. It's the first one mentioned. It's buckled about your waist. Now, sometimes our jeans fit pretty well, or our pants. We don't need a belt, but sometimes not. And that's when you get this one article of clothing that kind of keeps it all tied together. Without that belt of truth, you might be in trouble. You don't want to have your pants falling down, right? Just as you dress yourself each morning, just as you put on that belt, imagine arraying yourself with all of that spiritual armor and a belt of truth. What would that change about the way you conduct your day? If you were prepared to carry the gospel, to carry the joy that comes with that, and the decency that comes with that, and all that armor so that you won't be slammed around by wickedness. Do you remember that lighthouse? In Matthew chapter 5, right after he got through all of those beatitudes, our Lord Christ told us that we are the light of the world and that we are to shine upon it. Now, I like to think of God as that lighthouse, but God is a lot more like that rock underneath it. He is the foundation. He's beneath that lighthouse. Waves can crash upon that rock. Earth can quake. But that rock does not move. And if the lighthouse is securely rooted upon that rock, it too will stand firm. In Matthew chapter 16, Christ stated, "Upon this rock I will build my church." The rock is that truth that Christ is Lord. There have been some throughout the centuries that claim that Christ meant Peter would be the rock. Peter means Petros. It's the male form of the Greek word. And Christ said, "You are Peter, Petros, and upon this rock, Petra," the female version of that word, "I will build my church." There's also another play, rock meaning Petros, so a very small little pebble. And Petra, it's like a boulder. It's like the rock pictured there underneath that lighthouse. So Christ was saying, "Peter, you've got this. You're a piece of the truth. And I am this huge boulder upon which you can build a lighthouse." Now, this rock, it does not waver. God is the rock is actually an amazing study. If you look throughout the Bible, it's amazing how consistently and how often the theme of God being a rock pops up. Of all the things God to choose, right, to be a rock, it's kind of ironic. But nevertheless, Christ is our truth. In him, you can set your anchor. And Christ alone can we stand against the wiles of the devil. Nothing else in this world, sadly, not ourselves, not even the people we look up to, not even our church, Not even our blessed country can live up to its mission or its target ideals. We can rely on nothing besides Christ. Put on that armor of God and ensure that you are rooted in Christ's truth. Do not worry about the fake news or the depressing things that you see that surround current events. Perhaps if we can do that, perhaps then we can spread the joy that we feel, that joy that wells up within you when you know Christ. The world certainly needs that joy, and whether it receives it or not, it's our duty to make Christ known, to spread his love, his truth, and his peace. Imagine what God could do through you and me if we together every day put on that armor of God. Imagine how our attitudes would change if every day we adorn breastplates of righteousness and belts of truth. Argument, protest, defiance, and just being generally miserable won't show our unbelieving neighbors how Christ has extracted us from this chaos. We have an unchanging God. His news is reliable. It's a rock. His identity is the essence of truth. Take comfort. Take joy. In his word, in his promise, and in his peace. And may God's Holy Spirit spread that far beyond any fear, any anger, or any trouble. And may that peace last longer than any virus. Amen.
Thank you.
to see in a world of confusion, in a world that's just falling apart. Anchor yourself to the rock of ages, the rock that is Jesus Christ. Hold true to him and let him guide your heart. We will only know peace when we fight for Christ. These other distractions that draw our focus away from the rock, they are only that, distractions. Focus on Christ, fight only for him, and find peace therein. May God bless us all and give us peace as we embrace his truth.